Greetings to all. Welcome to the next tutorial of the channel Explicit Radius. So in this tutorial we will talk about very important topic named as hourglass. So it is very important to know hourglass because of many reasons. Those reasons we will discuss in the tutorial. So let's continue on the topic. So this is the initial beam component before deformation, and when some load is applied on this edge and that beam is going to deform in such a way, those red things are nothing but the deform element. So by applying such a limited load like 1 newton or 100 newton on the steel material, such deformation will never occur. But if we have hourglassing phenomena, or we can say model having hourglass energy, such deformation will take place. So this excessive deformation is cause of wrongly interpreted results. So this condition is without controlling the hourglass phenomena. We have some control options for the hourglass, and here the same component with same boundary conditions with hourglass controlled is used, and here you can see the deformation value is very limited, and that is actually very good result. And we can verify such those results by analytic method also. In the later slides I gone for analytic method also, and where I found the deformation is around 1.9 mm, and here with the hourglass control options the deformation in the cantilever beam is 1.89 mm. So it is very accurate, but in this case where we don't have hourglass control for the cantilever beam subject to the bending load, such problem may be occur, such excessive deformation may be occur. So let's continue on the topic. So this is the another example where we can see the effect of the hourglass. So this flask is the made of steel component, and in this case, in the first case, it's look like a flask is made of some very thin rubber or somewhat like. Even I applied the gravity loading on the component along the y direction and give some initial displacement. What I thought, it should be oscillate about this axis likewise, but what happened if I don't go for the hourglass controlling, this model is look like, or this model simulate like that. Obviously that result is a very bad result, and we can say the hourglass energy here take place. Due to that hourglass energy, there will be excessive deformation in the element. So why this hourglass energies appear and why this excessive deformation will appear, we will talk on it. So let me talk on the hourglass effect. So as you seen in the previous two slides, there is excessive deformation in the element, in the particular element, and the other element may not deform. You can see those elements are not going to deform too much, but those elements after deformation will look like that. This is the excessive deformation, and here also those elements are taking too much deformation value. So don't think this is the excessive deformation and this is not the excessive deformation. Why? Because this component is made of steel, and the thickness of the sheet is around 1 mm. So you can see if you give an initial displacement to any kitchen utensils or you can say flask, it never be deformed such like that. It will be oscillate about the axis. So this condition is also called as a excessive deformation condition. Okay, so in hourglass we have excessive deformation. In other way, we can say element having the zigzag mode or hourglass shape mode. This may not appear all times, the zigzag shape. Here you can see the zigzag shape will be appearing, and here the zigzag shape is not appearing. So it may possible that deformation is somewhat limited, the zigzag shape will be appear, otherwise there will be too much excessive deformation and we can't even see the original component. Okay, like that. So again, go for the same slide. So as I told you, in the hourglass we get zigzag shape, and we can see here this is the zigzag shape, this is the zigzag shape, or you can see here this is the zigzag shape of the element, and so on. Okay, on hourglass shape, the hourglass shape is nothing the shape of the flask you ever seen in we have one glass like that, and on that glass that glass having shape like that. Okay, so this glass is called the hourglass, and the similar shape of the element we are getting here. See, this shape versus this shape. This shape we are getting as a hourglass. This shape we are getting as a hourglass. Actually, this model is the 3D model, and some element are hourglassed, or we can say take hourglass shape along the Z direction. So maybe some element you don't find the hourglass shape, but in most of the element you are able to find the hourglass shape. So that's why that phenomena known as the hourglass phenomena. Okay, as I told you, severe deformation will be up here. Some of the element may be undeformed, and it is not necessary that hourglass phenomena will appear on the 2D element only. It can be appear in 2D element and 3D element as well as. But there is some condition for the hourglass, when the hourglass will be appear. So here we have one technique, that is the reduced element scheme. So in the reduced element scheme, basically we found the hourglass phenomena when component, or we can say element, subject to the bending load. So let me talk more on the hourglass, why it is appears. Before talk on the hourglass, let me clear one thing. There we have two type of element, basically linear and quadratic element, otherwise we can say first order and second order element. In the first order element, we have nodes only on the corner of the element. Likewise, in the second order element, we have node on the corner as well as on the mid edges likewise. Okay, so now this element is the second order element. These circles are representing here the node. Okay, and that red point or red circle is representing the integration point. So if you're not aware about the integration point, you can understand the integration point of the element is the point where the all calculation is done for the stress strain or deformation and so on. So let me clear those points. So in the first order element, we have two type of scheme, that first known as the reduced integration scheme, and second one is known as the FI full integration scheme. Similarly, we have reduced and full integration scheme in quadratic element, or we can say second order element, and similarly we have this technique in the 3D element. So in the reduced integration scheme, what we have only the one integration point on the mid of the element. In the full integration scheme, we have four integration point for the quad element. Right now I'm talking only on the first order quad element, okay, not on the second order element, not on the 3D element. I'm talking only about the first order quad elements. So in the first order quad element, in the reduced integration scheme, we have only one integration point, and in the full integration scheme, we have these four integration point. These integration points are decided by Gauss quadrature formula. For more, you can go for the Gauss quadrature formulation. There are many type of integration point formulation we have, 2x2 integration form. So see, this is the 2x2 integration form. Apart from, we have 3x3 integration form and more. So generally, most of the CAE tool for full integration scheme using 2x2 integration scheme. In the 2x2 integration scheme, we have the four integration point as shown in the figure. Okay, so when 2D or 3D element with coarse meshing, so if you have very fine meshing, there is maximum chances that hourglass phenomena will not occur. But if we have the coarse meshing and integration scheme that we are using is reduced integration scheme, and our component is subject to the bending load, so this phenomena may occur. There is high chances of occurring this phenomena, hourglass phenomena. One thing that I want to clear, for second order element, or we can say quadratic elements, we don't have such hourglassing effect. I will clear that thing. Only for the first order elements and reduced integration scheme, we are getting the hourglassing problem. And for the first order full integration scheme, we have another problem, that known as shear-Locking. We will talk on that also. Okay, so see, if the element is subject to, here we are talking only on the one element, if the element is subject to the bending load, so what should be appear ideally this should be happen. Okay, this edge should be compressed and this edge should be in the tension. Okay, and that angle between the horizontal and vertical laminas should be remain 90 degree. So if the angle remain 90 degree, we can say there is no shearing, but lamina of the element is compressed and tension like is in bending. So in this case we can say the bending is taking place in the element. But what is the problem actually? The first order reduced integration scheme, or we can say first order element itself, either they are a reduced integration scheme or they are in full integration scheme, first order element can't take that curvature shape during the bending load. What will happen? These elements are going to be take a shape like that. As we can see here, this edge is subject to the tension, so that's why the length of this edge will be increased, and this edge is subject to the compression, so length of this edge will be decreased. Our original element was like that. Okay, so this was our original element. So as I told you, in the reduced integration scheme, all our calculation is done on the only one integration point. Okay, so here at the integration point, neither length of the lamina change nor the angle of this dotted line will be changed. So what problem we will face when this change we will not occur in the element? See, change in length indicate axial strain. So how software will calculate the strain, or we can say physically also we are calculating strain as change in length divided by actual length. So if the lamina will not change its length, software will assume there will be no strain. Okay, similarly, if the angle will be not changed, as we know for the shearing condition what this is the element, and after deformation this element will be look like that. So this angle is nothing but our shear angle, and this phenomena is representing the shearing. But what happened here, the angle of the laminas is not changing. Of course there should not be change in the angle if element is subject to the bending load. In this case also, laminas having 90 degree, don't bother about this angle. I'm not good in design, so these designs are made by me, and there may be some little mistake, but what I want to see show you here, this angle should not be changed when it is subject to, or when element is subject to the bending load. Okay, here we are talking on this element because this is the case for the second order element. But for the first order element, when element is subject to the bending load, edge will not take curvature shape, they will be directly compressed or tensed like that. Okay, so if there is no change in angle, and if there is no change in the length of the dotted line, or we can say lamina, there will be no shear strain as well as the bending strain, but still the deformation is take place in the element. So such bending mode of the deformation in the element is zero energy mode, because there is no strain energy, but still element are going to distort. Okay, so due to that, what will happen, without any energy the element get distort, and they are distort excessively. If once element start deforming, they will be start throughout, and excessive deformation we have here. So that's why hourglass phenomena will occur. See, still this element is the first order element. Okay, first order element, we have four node. If we have node here also, then only this element will be called as a second order element. Okay, so let me clear those things. So now this element is the first order element with full integration scheme. Here most of the cases we did not have hourglass phenomena, but we may face the shear locking when element is subject to the bending load. This should be happen actually, the lamina angle should not be changed, this angle should still 90. But in this case where we have the first order element, the angle between two lamina will be changed, that not remain 90. So due to the bending, there is change in the shear angle. So this bending is cause of the shear energy, and the overall effect of the shear energy will be log the element. Here you can see angle is decreasing and here you can see the angle is increasing. So the overall effect locks the elements, and that is known as the shear locking. So right now we will not talk on the shear locking in too much deep. We have to talk on the hourglass effect. So if you have a full integration scheme, there will be no hourglass, but shear locking may be appear. And to remove the shear locking cause, we have to increase the number of element along the bending. If I go for take 3 or 4 or 5 element along the bending, so assume that is the constraint from here and one load is applied here. If I am going to define 3 or 4 element along the bending, there will be chances that shear locking will be disappear. Here we can see the quadratic element, or we can say second order element, will never be subject to the shear locking as well as the hourglass. Why? Because hourglass is appearing when this edge is not taking the curvature shape, but the second order element have this facility. Those edges can take the curvature shape. Okay, so as those edges take curvature shapes, those lamina can also take curvature shape. And as we can see, some lamina are in the compression and some lamina are in the tension. So software will able to calculate the stress strain value. As well as we can see here, due to the bending load, there will be no change in the angle of the lamina. There might be look like this angle is not 90 degree, but in actual case this angle is exactly 90 when we are going for full integration scheme of second order element. Okay, so now it is clear to you, the hourglass phenomena occur when we have reduced integration scheme first order element. Okay, if we have full integration scheme first order element, no hourglass will be appear, but shear locking may be appear. And if we have quadratic or second order element with full integration scheme, there will be no hourglass and no shear locking. Now you may have question, then why we are not using always the second order element? First thing, as we are going to increase the number of integration point, it will take more time to compute. See, in this case the result is going to calculate only on the one point. In this case the result is going to calculate on the four point for the element, for the single element. And in this case the result are going to compute at the 9.9 integration point for the single element. So as we are going to compute result for the more integration point, the simulation will take more time. So this is the one of reason why we are looking for the reduced integration scheme most of the time. It will take less time to simulate the behavior. But in such cases where we having the hourglass phenomena, we need to go for the full integration scheme. Okay, and most of the software like I know about the HyperWorks and Abaqus, they are not allowed to use second order element for the explicit solver, where we can use only on the first order element with the reduced integration scheme or with the full integration scheme. Even we can't go for the second order hex element. This I am talking about the explicit solver. That is the Abaqus and HyperWorks. I am not aware much about the LS Dyna and ANSYS and Nostron, but I seen in LS Dyna tutorial they talk about some 8 node quad element. They may be use second order element for the explicit. Of course those element will take too much time to solve the problem. Very specific case may we have for the second order full integration scheme. Okay, so next we will talk about how we can diagnose the hourglass. Look, sometime by manual inspection you can't even predict the hourglass is occurring in some specific elements or in some specific component. So I always recommend to use the energy plot for the each component of the assembly, and especially those are the subject to the bending load. In the crash analysis, if you are looking for the component, the bumper is subject to the bending load, and the front bonnet and those many components are subject to the bending load. So there we have to look for the hourglass energy plot. So this hourglass energy plot you have to compare with respect to the internal energy or total energy. Okay, If the hourglass energy is exceed 5% of the total energy, that should not be acceptable. In some cases, we are accepting up to 10% also. In the previous slides, you seen as the hourglass energy is increasing, the results are deviate from the originality. And sometime we can manually inspect the hourglass energy, as I told you in the first and second case. See, in this case, you are able to easily inspect the hourglass energy, the excessive deformation of the element, and in this case also. But there are many cases where you can't inspect the hourglass energy. Okay, so as I told you, we have to go for the plot of the hourglass energy with respect to the internal energy. You can see here, for the first case of the flask where we don't have hourglass control, the internal energy is going to increase when I feed some initial displacement, and then it will be going to decrease continuously, but not the hourglass energy. Is the hourglass energy is increasing drastically. It should be approximate zero or within the 5 or 10%, but what happening here, the hourglass energy is too much high as compared to the internal energy. That's why we are having such this type of misleading behavior. When I go for the hourglass control in the element, this behavior is appearing. See, the internal energy is going to decrease continuously. Okay, this component is going to oscillate about that axis, so that's why the energies look like little bit zigzag, and the hourglass energy is totally zero. Okay, so this is the very correct result, and this is the worst result. We can't accept those results, and sometime we may feel that the initial displacement may too much higher due to that component is having such behavior. But look, the flask is made of steel material, and I am going to give some initial displacement. Is it possible and that component behave like that? No, never it is possible. Okay, so that's why those results are completely worst result. Okay, in some cases the results look like very good. Even we can say here, if I go for one cantilever beam, applying some load here and fix from this end, okay, the deformation will be take place, and that deformation look like very real. You can think that the load is very high, that's why the deformation is too much. But the actual condition is we have only 1 newton load here, okay, and due to the 1 newton load, the deformation, or we can say maximum displacement value, should be 0.016 mm only. What displacement we are occurring here? Around 90 mm. So this is the completely false result, and this is the cause of the hourglass energy. Again, same thing we are getting here. Due to such cases, the hourglass energy will be take place. We have coarse meshing, element are subject to the bending load, and reduced integration scheme. So due to such, we are getting again and again such cases. Okay, so I always recommend to check the hourglass energy with respect to the internal energy. Here you can see, this is the hourglass energy that is too much high as compared to the internal energy. Even we can see the internal energy look like zero as compared to the hourglass energy, but it should be reverse. The hourglass energy should be approximate zero, and internal energy should be increasing or maybe decreasing, depend on your boundary conditions. So always go for check the hourglass plot. Okay, so you may think the hourglass phenomena occur only on the 2D element, but here the case of the 3D element. Okay, this is the initial condition of the elements. The same beam I am taking here with load of 100 newton. Okay, load is here 100 newton. You may think 100 newton is too much high. No, 100 newton is not high for this case. This beam having steel material length around 100 mm, thickness around 1 mm, and height is 10 mm. For the 100 newton load, it never be deformed like that. It is deforming like that because of the hourglass energy. Here see, up to the certain time limit, like 80 milliseconds, the component behavior is very good, but after that suddenly hourglass energy is changing because of the bending. Okay, the same phenomena as I told you earlier. So once you know the hourglass phenomena and you know how to diagnose this hourglassing in the elements or in the components, let me tell you one example. So firstly, the cantilever beam, this beam we are assuming as a 2D element with thickness of 1 mm. Okay, so having length of 100 mm, this is the length, height is around 10 mm, and width, or we can say thickness of the beam, is 1 mm, and the force here at the end of the beam is 100 N. Okay, only on the one node. So these are the material parameters, linear material I assumed, and this is the second moment of inertia of the beam about this axis, because when we go for the analytical result, we need this I value. I value is nothing but second moment of inertia about the bending axis. So when we put these all value in the deformation value, the analytically we can see this will give us the maximum deformation, and when we put those all value in this formula, the deformation is around 1.9 mm. Okay, and when we go for simulate this behavior with hourglass control, the deformation is around 1.89, or we can say 1.9 mm. So this result is very accurate, and here we can see the hourglass energy is approximate. The red line is representing here the hourglass energy. The hourglass energy is approximate zero, and internal energy is going to continue increase. Why? Because deformation will take place and this simulation will be stopped at the end of the deformation, so the energy will be stored in the object. That's why the energy is, internal energy is continuous increasing. Okay, so how you can go for addressing the hourglass? You know, by manual inspection or maybe by the plotting graph of the hourglass energy with respect to the internal energy, then how to address the hourglassing. So there are four way to address the hourglassing. So these first two techniques are a little bit tricky, and we need to know more about the physics of the component as well as the parameters which we are using in the CAE software. So maybe those parameters according to the different software will be different, but those two things are approximate same for the all software. First thing is the refining the mesh. As we go for refined mesh, there may be chances of reducing the hourglass energy, or we can, or may no hourglass energy. And another thing, if we go for use the fully integrated element, there are chances the hourglass energy will be removed, or hourglass energy is approximate the zero. So let me talk on the same example that I told you earlier. This example, first we are going for simulate this behavior without hourglass control, and then second we are going to simulate the behavior with hourglass control. Okay, so in different solvers we have different way for the reduced integration scheme and for the full integration scheme. So here I am talking in term of hyperworks. Okay, just go for hyperworks, and here open, I already made the model, so I'm just going to open that model. So this is the hourglass example beam, 2D beam with no hourglass control. Okay, just I'm going to open this .hm file. Material parameter, boundary condition, those all are decided. Here you can see the material, here the parameters value are in mm, kg and ms, that is the millisecond, that's why those parameter look like that. Similarly, I go for applying the boundary conditions. Here we have constraint, and this is the load. Actually this symbol is representing load in upward direction, but this load is actually in the lower direction. Okay, don't bother about the symbol. Okay, see, in the property of the element, here we can see ISL 24 is used for the full integration scheme. Here I am not going to use any full integration scheme, I am just going to opt the integration, full integration scheme. So just go for save the file. Okay, this cantilever beam is very easy to model, easy to apply load and boundary conditions, so I am not going to give the time for the modeling. I just want to tell you here the effect of the hourglass. So just save your file. After saving, go for simulate the behavior, and here the options NP6 is nothing but number of processors or cores. I'm using here 6 cores. Save your file in the new folder named, I'm going to define as 0.1. This model I already simulated, that's why I'm not going to simulate in the same folder. I'm going to simulate in new folder. Okay, just go for save and just go for hit on the radius button. Now simulation will start. Okay, so in the matter of millisecond or microsecond, the simulation is finished, and only the two simulation files are written here, A001 simulation file and A002 simulation file. Why? Because the error in the energy is too much high, 99.9% around. Why? Because of the excessive distortion of the element, and these things we can see in the hyperview also. So just go for look at hyperview, go for open your file, and where is my file? In the hourglass example 1.1, and I'm going to open A001 file. Just hit on the apply button, go for some standard view, check on the shaded mode of the element, and just play. See, just pause it and go for the last increment stage. See, these elements are distorted too much high due to of the hourglass. Even you can't see the component. Where is my component? Just go for the first frame and hit on the fit on screen button, and now again go for the last frame. See, so this may cause of the hourglass energy. Okay, so now in the second case, what I'm going to do, just save this file, the previous file, go for open the new file, go for open, and here we have hourglass control, and see, nothing is changed except the ISAL formulation is 24. That 24 is nothing but 4 integration scheme. Similarly, we can use the ISAL 12 also. This is also 4 integration scheme. There is some difference between the ISAL 12 and ISAL 14. For more, you can go for the help file. Okay, so just go for save your model. I am defining name as 02.2. Save, go for radios, simulate the behavior. For that you have to save, and just go for hit on the radius button. So now simulation will be start without any error message. You can see here there is no error, and see, software is start writing animation files. Okay, so let's complete the simulation, then we will go for check the results. Okay, the same thing we seen for the another model, that was, let me open the flask model. Till that maybe our simulation will be complete. Okay, so just go for open. Okay, so this one is the file with hourglass control, flask hourglass control, and go for open that model, go for apply. Okay, and just go for the page control and split your page into two part. Click on this second screen, go for open your another file that is with no hourglass control. Just hit on the apply button. Okay, now this is the case where we have hourglass controlling, and this is the case where we don't have the hourglass controlling. Just hit on the simulation button, make sure you are in the transient animation mode. Okay, just click on the apply. See, This component is oscillating about this axis. The speed is very low, and the second thing, the simulation is run only for the half second around, so that's why this is not even taking the complete one oscillation. So here just go for see the displacement result, and very actual result you can feel here, or you can see from the another angle also. Okay, and this is obviously non-realistic result, and due to the hourglass energy there is huge deformation in the element. Okay, if you want to see the hourglass energy plot in the same window, just go for split your window in the four part and hit on the screen. Make sure you are in the hypergraph mode. Okay, open your file. Here you have hourglass examples. In hourglass examples, just go for flask with hourglass control, and here you have to find the T01 file. That is nothing but your hypergraph file. Okay, so once you select the file, the global variable will be up here. If you given some output request, those also will be available here. Just check on the internal energy, as well as go for the check on the hourglass energy with control button, and now go for magnitude and preview. You can see in this way the hourglass energy and internal energy will be plot. Okay, so for this model similarly you have to go for the hyperview, open the file, no hourglass control, and open the T01 file, internal energy as well as hourglass energy, magnitude, go for preview it and hit on the apply button. Okay, add this toolbars that you can visualize more clearly. Okay, see, okay, and I'm just going to off the synchronize options here. So you can see here the hourglass energy for the component is approximate zero with the hourglass control options. And here if you don't go for hourglass control, or in the hyperworks case, you can say if I'm not going to use the ICEL formulation 24 or 12, or we can say if you are not going to use the full integration scheme, the hourglass energy may be too much high. Okay, so now let me see the simulation is completed, the previous simulation. Just go for open the new page by hit on the add page options, and again similar way split your screen in two part and just check on these panels, side panels and bottom panels. Make sure you are in the hyperview. Okay, we already opened the file. Yeah, here we already opened the file, and just go for split this screen in two part, go for open your results of the beam component with hourglass control. So here 2.2 S3D file, and just hit on the apply button, go for some standard view, make sure the shaded mode, go for apply some result displacement value and apply. Okay, go for the last frame, and here you are having the displacement value 1.89. and in this case if you are going to check the displacement, that will be around too much high, even no need to plot the result. Let's go for the clear contour. Okay, so in slide we also seen that result is very accurate to the analytical one, and here you can see The same deformation value we are getting for the analytical or hand calculation, and same deformation we are getting for the simulation also. Okay, so this is all about the hourglass effect and how to overcome with the hourglass energy or hourglass effect. I am always recommend to use the plot for the hourglass energy if those components are subject to bending load in the assembly. In the most of the complex assemblies where like we have crash analysis or subject to some impact or drop test, there it is always recommended to give the output request for the component and check the hourglass energy for the individual component. Okay, so hope you learn something about hourglass energy, and now you are aware about the hourglass energy. And if you having such any problem, now you are able to deal with this. In the different software, of course, the formulation for the full integration scheme will be different. But if you are aware to the tool or your software, you can easily find where is the full integration scheme. In Abaqus, like I have Abaqus solver also. And see, this is my, I'm going to go for the another component, that is the plate component. Okay, for that plate component, if I want to go for full integration scheme, just go for here the element type. Okay, I already made the component and made the assembly from the part, and just go for mesh and go for type of element. For the explicit, see, for the explicit software is unable to define quadratic element. Okay, if you go for the Abaqus standard, the both linear and quadratic elements are available. If you go for the Abaqus explicit, only the linear element is available. And if you want to go for the full integration scheme, just uncheck this options. Now we have the full integration scheme for the element. Whatever mesh we are going to do, that will be with full integration scheme. And if you check this options, now the element will be created with reduced integration scheme. So it is very easy to use in Abaqus and maybe in another software. In HyperWorks, you have to take care only about the iCell formulation, which formulation used for which condition. So iCell 24 and iCell 12 is used for full integration scheme. So that's all, and thank you for listening.